Okay. Wow. This is really loud. So welcome to my talk on SAR. Who of you is using radar remote sensing already in the research? Hey, there are hands. There's a hand. You don't count, Andy. My name is Franz Meyer. I'm the chief scientist of the Alaska Satellite Facility. We host NASA's archive for SAR data, and I'm a big fan of SAR. And hopefully, at the end of the talk, I'm gonna convince you that you also should become a big fan of SAR and invest in using SAR in your research. So SAR is a great tool in Earth observation, and so it's not a big secret that because it uses radar wavelength, it's a 24/7 capable instrument. One of the few Earth observation instruments that can truly observe dynamic processes on the ground regularly. And so we are using it a lot in hazard monitoring. You see on the side here, this is a volcanic activity. You see some growth of a volcanic dome for a volcano in Alaska. And only SAR was able to monitor this event given the strong cloud coverage that we have over this region. So it's a very useful instrument. But in the past, SAR has been held back a little bit by a few reasons. One of them was that SAR, if anybody ever tried SAR, is complicated. So it required a lot of expert knowledge to be able to process data sets to useful geophysical information. Past SAR systems also had the problem that they were sampled very irregularly. So you never knew when the next data sets came in. So that was a problem if you wanted to do hazard monitoring. But even in geophysics, you sometimes undersampled your signal that you were interested in, so it wasn't as useful as it could have been. And lastly, SAR data used to be very expensive. So the higher resolution data sets you needed to pay for. So that was a problem too if you were interested in continuous observation of the planet. But there's good news. So there's a few really important things that happened over the recent few years that make SAR now much more interesting to a lot of you, I hope. One of them is that we now have brand new data sets, brand new sensors in space, such as Sentinel-1, the upcoming NISAR mission, which is a NASA-based entry, and a future mission called TANML. And these data, first of all, these systems are providing very large-scale data sets very regularly at a high predictable repeat frequency, so that now you can look at geophysical phenomena like ice export, and you can track them and understand them very nicely by looking at these repeated images. This is independent of cloud cover, independent of weather conditions, and you can track these phenomena continuously. Furthermore, these data sets are now free of charge. So all of these global data sets are available to you free of charge at your fingertips. To access these data sets, we've worked a lot on improving search and download clients. So the Alaska Satellite Facility is operating a client called Vertex. There's a link. I think this is being recorded, so you can look up the link later today. So these are easy clients that allow you to, they are free of charge. Again, it's very easy to register. It's a very quick and easy registration. It's actually a one password sign-on. So if you already have a password for another NASA data set, the same password will work for Vertex. It's a very easy way of searching data, and you have access to the global archive. Furthermore, we made data sets a little bit more straightforward to use. We are starting to provide data sets fully geocoded, fully terrain corrected, in easy to use GIS ready formats such as GeoTIFF, HDF5, and similar formats. And we also are starting to experiment with new value added products. I'm going to show you more on the next slide that are a little more easier to understand for people that are not experts in SAR. So we, for instance, we do color-coded SAR images that have a look and feel that is more akin to an optical satellite. Finally, there's a lot of services that have been spinning up around SAR, around these new SAR datasets. And these services are providing to you what we call application-ready products. So these are derived products from original SAR observations that are easier to ingest in research data flows. There's a series of these services that are already existing. One of the first ones was the JPL-based ARIA system, but there's also COMET, which is a European entry, SARViews, which is at the University of Alaska Fairbanks, and the thematic exploitation platforms that are being developed by the European Space Agency. So all of those provide data sets like deformation maps right out of the box. You don't have to calculate them yourself anymore. The color-coded images, in time series of amplitude images that are easy to use for change detection, for tracking applications of dynamic phenomena. Beyond that, we are providing you now, so if the product that you need is not yet available, we're providing help for you that explains to you step by step how can you create a value-added product from SAR. So we have recipes available, for instance, at the Alaska Satellite Facility, step-by-step descriptions of processing flows. Very easy to use. And lastly, we have new clients, new platforms, new software platforms. Past platforms tended to be complicated to use. They had complicated interfaces. They used language that was not familiar to most people. This platform called SNAP, Sentinel Applications Platform, is a very straightforward, easy-to-use system with very clear menu guidance that a lot of you will be able to use. And so lastly, if you are intrigued by SAR, if you want to learn a little bit more about what SAR is about, there's a lot of help available now for you on the web, freely available. At the Alaska Satellite Facility, we maintain a full semester course on SAR that is completely freely available on the web. So all the lecture material is available for download and for analysis, including labs and all of the different components. I'm not sure if you're familiar with RSET. RSET is a NASA-based training group. RSET stands for Applied Remote Sensing Education and Training. And they maintain a very nice introduction course for SAR in both English and Spanish at this web address that you can also look up later today. And finally, the European Space Agency ran a massive online, massive open online class on SAR. And all the material is still available. It was live in fall 2017 this year, but the material is available at eo-courses.org. So if you're interested in that, then please look it up. So I hope that I could convince you that a lot of things have changed in SAR, and it's much more interesting nowadays for you to use in your research. And if you have further questions, if you want to know more about SAR, if you want to follow latest developments, and please look us up on Twitter, where we always post the latest news about SAR. Thanks a lot.